Hi everybody, I'm Heather Dawson. Welcome to California Life. Well, we created a segment called Spotlight because we feel there's a lot of interesting places to visit in this beautiful state. In this week's Spotlight, Lisa Spalla takes us inside the most glamorous city in the world, Hollywood.
It's been called many things, Tinseltown, the home of the stars, America's movie capital, but there's nothing quite like it in the world. And tonight we're turning the spotlight as we welcome you to Hollywood.
Tinseltown's most famous landmark is the Hollywood sign. Built in 1923, it first read Hollywood Land. The image represents the universal symbol for success, glamour, and opportunity. However, in 1939, during the Great Depression, maintenance stopped on the sign. A decade passed before the Chamber of Commerce restored the landmark to read Hollywood.
I will say I think it was a little more collegial in the early days than today because all of the merchants lived here. Or the people that lived here, most of them were in the movie business. This is a pretty big community right now. It's alive, and the name Hollywood is still magic.
Just 1 year before the sign's big debut, the hills became alive with the sound of music.
A group of people who are music lovers discovered that this area, this canyon that we're in, had a natural acoustic that was very good for music.
The Hollywood Bowl opened its doors in 1922, and for over 70 years has been home to the LA Philharmonic. The outdoor amphitheater with its iconic dome has featured the biggest performers in the world, crossing all musical genres.
I think it's one of those places that anybody who plays here will tell you is, you know, you've sort of made it when you play the Hollywood Bowl.
Spring is like on Jupiter and Mars.
I've been coming to the Hollywood Bowl since I've come to Hollywood. It is part of Los Angeles. It's a cultural event. It is such a pleasure to come here in this setting and to hear the music and eat the food and have it all combined. It's a sensual, intellectual experience that can't be equaled anywhere else as far as I'm concerned.
And if it's good eats you're looking for, Yamashiro Restaurant is a must-do in Hollywood.
So give us an example of some of like your signature dishes.
Well, the most popular dishes that go out are obviously the filet and the grilled seafood with the lemongrass cream sauce. But the signature dishes, well, the dishes that I like is we have these barbecue ribs that are on the menu, and what it is basically we dry rub it, traditional American style dry rub, and we actually glaze it with I would like to call it a Korean style barbecue sauce, and it gives us kind of like a sweet spiciness to it. Mm-hmm. It's wonderful, mashed sweet potatoes, and it's just to die for.
Hollywood went through a period there where not only did the tourists not come, but the stars didn't even want to come down here. And now, by heavens, we've got a long list that have already been approved, and we're going to be doing a lot of stars.
And on Hollywood Boulevard is the most famous movie house, the Grauman's Chinese Theater. Aligning the boulevard are the stars on the Walk of Fame. For nearly 30 years, the late honorary mayor of Hollywood, Johnny Grant, presented this honor to the likes of Gene Autry, Drew Barrymore, Ozzy Osbourne, and his very good pal, the late legendary Bob Hope.
Bob Hope used to call me. He'd say, what do I have to do? Learn how to ride to get another star?
Across the street is Hollywood's most famous and haunted hotel, the Roosevelt, which was host to the very first Academy Awards in the Blossom Room in 1929.
Well, the Roosevelt is the hottest spot in town right now, and they have really done a great job of turning that hotel around.
And after more than 70 years, Oscar has found its way back home right here in Hollywood at the Kodak Theater.
The Hollywood Highland Complex, you've got the Chinese Theater. You got everything right in there. It's a jumping place. It's kind of like going to Bethlehem. You know you're not going to see the original cast, and you're not going to see it here either, but you'll see where it took place.
And he always said that cycling just gave him a lot of joy. You know, it was very social because he always rode with his friends. and he was absolutely convinced that it didn't matter who you were or how old you were, you could ride a bike. Hi, I'm Gail Krause. I'm involved with Ride the Point because my husband, Jim Krause, was an avid cyclist, and he had just completed 6 century rides on his bicycle when he was diagnosed with pancreatic cancer in May of 2008.
Yeah, I'm Rich Staklem. I'm the ride director for Ride the Point, and I'm also a member of the Point Loma Rotary Club. Jim Krause was a member of our club. He was president of our club at one time and was a good friend of mine. Even while he was being treated for pancreatic cancer, he was riding his bike. The Ride the Point event is every Veterans Day on the Veterans Day weekend. That's Saturday. We leave from Liberty Station. We go through the Navy base all the way up to Point Loma. It has some spectacular views. And then it comes down and goes around Mission Bay. And if you're on the 25-mile ride, we bring you back to Liberty Station. We have a big party at Liberty Station with beer and food and celebrate the fact that people are raising money to help pancreatic cancer.
Hi, my name is Jim Piper, and I'm a member of Point Loma Rotary. And I volunteer for the Ride the Point Pancreatic Cancer Research Ride because pancreatic cancer is an insidious disease. This is our 7th year. We're hoping and fully believe that the amount of effort we put into this is really, really helping solve pancreatic cancer.
Yeah, so the funds from Ride the Point, actually, we've used the last couple of years to do something very interesting. We noticed that even though there was a higher response rate with a higher dosing of Tarceva, there was a group of patients who weren't responding. We wondered why. And so there really turns out to be a ceiling that you can't get above in terms of drug absorption. So we found ways over the last year or so to get around that and give higher doses and more effective doses to patients with less toxicity.
Since I became involved with this event, I've gotten to know many people personally that have suffered the loss from pancreatic cancer. And with this event, one of the most satisfying parts of it is that we see how that money is used. It goes directly to the Moores Cancer Center researchers, and they tell us what they're doing with the money.
This is a great event to get involved in. As a sponsor, you get more than your money's worth. We advertise all over the world. We have flyers that go out, 10,000 impressions on flyers. We have websites. We have electronic media that we go out with. We have people come from Europe as well as the Far East to come and ride in our ride, so you're getting a very diverse crowd. You certainly get your money's worth out of the advertising.
The tenacity of Jim to keep riding after every major surgery, to get back up on the bike, riding and finishing the race, it was important to finish the ride.
This event could not be held without volunteers. Volunteers do everything. We have a volunteer committee. We have volunteers that stand out on the route and cheer people on and ring crowd bells so they know where to turn and where to stop. And we also have people who ride with them in case they have problems on their bikes. We have people there with them that can render first aid, fix the bike, do whatever they need. And so you get this full support. We have 6 rest stops full of food, stocked with stuff that people have voluntarily given to us. So it's a great event. Even if you're not a bike rider, come out and enjoy the community.
He was treated at Moores Cancer Center, where he got the best care on the planet, I know, and ultimately succumbed to the disease in August of 2012. So the Rotary came to me and asked how the family would feel about them putting on a bike ride in Jim's memory. And of course, we were all very enthusiastic, and the result is Ride the Point.
One of the newest such fillers is called Radiesse. Physicians say it's safe, long-lasting, and an outstanding alternative to natural collagen.
At the Medical and Skin Spa in Indian Wells, getting rid of wrinkles, sagging skin, is a common patient request.
As we age, a bunch of things happen, none of which are any good, actually. Your face seems to fall in, and what you want to do is you want to open it up.
Dr. Richard Fox uses one of the newest treatments to provide smooth skin. Radiesse was first introduced about 7 years ago and has proven to be a safe and effective alternative for those patients wishing to preempt plastic surgery and avoid the potential side effects of bovine and solid implant materials.
It uses calcium, and it's the same calcium you find in the teeth and bones, but again, it's made in the laboratory, so there's no allergic problem.
Radiesse is injected into the wrinkle through a tiny needle and placed just under your skin. Unlike other fillers, Radiesse is not absorbed by your system.
You can do a meaningful correction and not have it gone in 2 months.
Depending on the area treated, most of your correction may last from 18 months up to 2 years. It can even be used on the bridge of your nose. For more information, contact Dr. Richard Fox at 760-674-4106. With today's HealthCast, I'm Tom Jordan.
Let's face it, many of us are looking for ways to drop a few pounds these days, and it seems every year a new fad diet becomes all the rage. Gluten-free, fat-free, sugar-free, carb-free, the list goes on and on. And while some people are just looking to lose some weight, others may be trying to deal with digestive issues. But unless prescribed by a doctor, these diets may not address the underlying problem.
Many people seek out these diets because they're really addressing some digestive issue that's going on and they don't know what to do about it. So they try perhaps eliminating gluten or another component of their diet. But I think that's a bit of a mistake. I think it's really important to address those symptoms with your doctor because sometimes those GI or those digestive symptoms could be a sign of an underlying GI condition, something like EPI, for example, which is exocrine pancreatic insufficiency, or other GI conditions that really need to be diagnosed and treated.
And certainly there are a number of digestive problems for your doctor to look at, many that have similar symptoms like irritable bowel syndrome, Crohn's disease, celiac disease, and a lesser known condition called EPI.
EPI is this condition where your pancreas is not functioning properly, which means it's not producing the digestive enzymes that you need to properly digest your food. That can result in symptoms like diarrhea, weight loss, abdominal pain, abdominal bloating. And you can tell that many of these symptoms are somewhat nonspecific, meaning that people may have them and think that it's something they ate or it may be a dietary issue. But whatever you may think it is, it's very important to discuss them with your doctor and get the appropriate evaluation to try to get the right answer, the right diagnosis.
And Dr. Raj says outside of visiting your doctor for a checkup, there are four things you can do to improve your digestive health.
Looking at your diet, first and foremost, you know, a well-balanced, nutritious diet is very important. It's getting enough sleep is something that a lot of people ignore but can have a huge impact on their health. Stress management, which certainly with digestive issues can make a big difference. And exercise. Exercise is great for your whole body, but it's also very good for your digestive system.
So if you are having digestive issues, don't self-diagnose. See your doctor right away. And to learn more about EPI, check out identifyepi.com. I'm David Wiley for California Life.
Up next on California Life, the movie The Changeling didn't win big at the Oscars, but the true story captivated audiences and even garnered actress Angelina Jolie an Oscar nomination. But the movie left out a compelling part of the true story. We went straight to the source, who happens to be a very important man in California. Stay tuned for my feature profile on Jack Brown and find out what role his family's story played in Clint Eastwood's movie, The Changeling. Well, we like to profile amazing people on our show, some of the best people in California. Jack Brown is not only the chairman and CEO of Stater Brothers, he's a philanthropist, a veteran of the U.S. Navy, a community leader, a father, and a son who honored his late father in a recent book. He's received dozens of awards and accolades for his work, ranging from Business Leader of the Year to the Horatio Alger Award, which he received alongside fellow winners Clarence Thomas and Henry Kissinger. Well, I had the pleasure of sitting down with Jack Brown at the new Stater Brothers headquarters in San Bernardino to bring you the special California profile.
One of the most brutal murder stories in California's history is portrayed in Clint Eastwood's Changeling. The movie tells the true story about the Wineville chicken coop murders in Riverside County. The killer, Gordon Northcott, escapes to Canada, but is later convicted of murder in Los Angeles and hung. However, what the movie left out is exactly how he was brought back to the United States. Jack Brown, chairman and CEO of Stater Brothers, wrote about this compelling portion of the story in Our Badge as a tribute to his father, San Bernardino County Deputy Sheriff Jack H. Brown. An expert investigator and unique tracker, Brown was asked to help another sheriff's department bring a notorious serial child murderer to justice in 1928. Yeah.
But my father had been raised in Kingman, Arizona, and his playmates were Shoshone Indians. And they taught him how to track and how to hunt and how to look for things unusual. And he was a horseman and a rodeo rider and all those things. He was a cowboy.
A cowboy that took matters into his own hands
when he learned Northcott had fled to Canada. So he got in his car and drove from California to Canada to bring the cocky killer to justice.
Where this fellow Northcott had been captured, he was so arrogant, said he'd never come back for trial, nobody'd ever get him. My father just decided to take him. Now, my dad was 260 pounds. He was a little over 6 foot tall, but he always wore cowboy boots with a couple inches of heel, and he always wore a white Stetson that was about 6 inches on the crown. So he's almost 7 foot tall. So when he grabbed Northcott and punched out the back door of this little constabulary jail, threw him in the car and drove straight through for 2 days to get to Riverside. But my father always had a aversion to what they call wife beaters, and also people who abuse children.
Always the gentleman, Brown even sent money for the door he kicked in, but he remained a wanted man in Canada. 2 years later, he put Northcott in handcuffs and rode with him on a train to San Quentin to be hung.
We have the handcuffs that Northcott wore.
Jack Brown has kept all of his father's memorabilia after his death in 1946, including the diamond-studded gold badge bestowed on his father by the citizens of San Bernardino County on Christmas Eve, 1930.
But he was deputized as a special deputy in Riverside County to ensure that the evidence he found would be admitted in court. So even in those days, they had to set all the legal precedences to get the only individual who was ever deputized to carry two badges at the same time. He was my hero. Everywhere we went, people wanted to talk to my father.
And a hero to the people in Wineville, California, a town so tarnished by the high-profile murder story, it was given a new name, Mira Loma. Jack Brown would love to see his father's courageous life played out on the big screen.
I can see Clint Eastwood playing my father.
Maybe someday he will. After all, Hollywood always loves a sequel.
You know actress Kyle Richards as one of the stars of The Real Housewives of Beverly Hills. And as fans of the show know, Real Housewives always has plenty of drama and lots of tears. But despite all that turmoil on the show, Kyle says the tears didn't come easy.
That seems like a little bit of a contradiction doing this dramatic show. But no, I started noticing on the first season of The Housewives that I was constantly having to use the artificial tears. Got to a point where I was so dependent on them that it was making me crazy. I was just uncomfortable all the time.
It came to the point where Kyle resorted to using artificial tears to help relieve the discomfort, but they just didn't give her the relief she needed.
Well, I was just incredibly uncomfortable, whether I was, you know, filming or out to lunch or working out, whatever it was. I was just very, very uncomfortable, and it was just a nuisance to always have to use those drops all the time.
Finally, that constant discomfort led Kyle to consult a doctor.
I eventually went to my eye doctor, and he diagnosed me with chronic dry eye.
Chronic dry eye is a condition where there are insufficient tears to lubricate and nourish the eye. And it turns out that chronic dry eye, like Kyle was suffering from, is not that uncommon. In fact, it affects many people for different reasons.
Age is the number one risk factor. As we get older, our bodies change, our hormonal levels change, and it puts us at risk for drying of the eyes. But younger people are just as vulnerable. Contact lens wearers, patients who have had some eye surgeries, pregnancy and hormonal changes, people who work in front of computers are very much vulnerable. We don't blink as much when we're on the computer and the eyes tend to get dry. So in my experience, there's been a lot of different variables that can cause dry eye, and people just like Kyle, who are sort of going through their days with irritated eyes, aware of their eyes all day long, and that's not a way to live.
So with Kyle's diagnosis of chronic dry eye, her doctor prescribed Restasis eye drops.
And I've been taking that ever since, and I've had amazing results, and now I don't feel so uncomfortable all the time, and I'm no longer so dependent on the artificial tears.
I'm David Wiley for California Life.
And that'll do it for us tonight. Thank you so much for watching California Life. I'm Heather Dawson. We'll see you next time.